Hi everyone, welcome and thank you for joining us live. Just a little bit of housekeeping before we start. Please add any questions to the chat box for our panelists to answer during our live Q&A at any time during today's live stream. And if you're excited for today's live stream and want more like it, then please make sure to subscribe to the Foundry YouTube channel. Joining me today, we have Vahik and Max from VineFX. And I'll just quickly introduce myself. I'm Anna. I'm one of the product managers on the Nuke team at Foundry, focusing on artist-facing tools and UX and UI improvements. And previously, I was a compositor. So I'm really excited to chat more about comp today. And I'll hand over to Vahik.
Hello, everyone. I'm Vahik. I'm a lead compositor at VineFX. I'll be happy to answer on all your questions after the stream. So, passing to you, Max.
Yeah, thanks. Hi, I'm Max Alexander, compositing supervisor / 2D supervisor at Vine. Been in the industry for about 12, 13 years. And yeah, excited to show what we've been working on.
Thank you both. It's great to have you on. I think we should just jump straight into it. So we're going to watch the VineFX 2023 showreel, and then we'll hop right into a deep dive on VineFX's work on BBC's Boat Story and Paramount Plus's No Escape. Thank you.
Hello and welcome everyone. My name is Vahik Asoyan. I'm a lead compositor at VineFX, an award-winning studio based in Cambridge, UK, founded by Michael Ellingworth,
With an expanding team, we have recently delivered shows like Boat Story, The Lazarus Project, The Witcher Season 3, The Tourist, and more. Today, I'll be happy to share our compositing approach across two projects. First up, we'll explore our work on the Paramount Plus thriller, No Escape, where we created Infinite Sea, Crashing Waves, and Violent Storms. Altogether, we delivered around 500 shots. And later, we'll explore the next project from BBC, Boat Story, on which Max joined us as a compositing supervisor and played a crucial role in shaping the final look. Let's start with one of the shots from No Escape. And currently this is the source plate. And this already looks really impressive. On-set crew did fantastic job creating practical elements like fog, mist, and rain, and all the small details within the actual set. Our task was to elevate it even further. That means that we have to think a way to make viewers to feel like they're right in the middle of Stormy Ocean. Let's check a few frames to have a better understanding of before and after. Creating a convincing VFX storm effect is no small effort. Beyond the technical challenges, we must seamlessly integrate all elements to achieve a result that will also mirror practical effects. This involves not only matching the colors of the added layers, but also ensuring that every component is positioned correctly relative to the camera. If we overlook the distance or speed of any specific element, it could compromise the entire shot. Even if the viewers can't pinpoint the exact issue, they'll sense that something isn't quite right. Before beginning to work on any shot, it's a good practice to divide it into smaller pieces. For this shot, we had four main tasks to solve: the camera match move, 3D ocean, particle effects, and also we had to make sure that everything is placed behind the actors and all the practical effects, splashes, rain, and small details. To keep things organized, I always start from the top and work my way to the bottom. I also add bookmarks and notes to the script. This helps other artists to understand and modify the work if needed. It also helps me to quickly find and change anything when I revisit a shot. First thing we have is the plate, which we needed to do some cleanup work. Next, we have a lot of roto nodes that we added to isolate the elements in the plate. I like to keep all the rotos in one place, so I can easily find and adjust them. This also makes sure that all the changes are applied throughout the script. We are using Houdini for all the FX and CG ocean, and in early tests we also used Nuke particles for rain and liked it, so we kept it and mixed it with the Houdini particles for some shots. I will explain more about this later. We have these main units where we combine all the CG channels together, and after that we edit on top of the plate. As we have a lot of practical stuff going on, like splash, mist, foam, and rain, we had to come up with a solution to keep all of these details and also add our effects behind of all of these elements and try to keep everything in balance. A combination of rotos and keyers helped to preserve all of the details from the set and add it back on top of our CG elements. We apply same technique of adding the elements throughout the script. We combine everything at the head unit. Then we do final tweakings. And after that, we add everything on top of the plate. Next step was to add our actors and all the elements from the boat inside the fog and rain elements. And one of the issues was that we had no metadata inside the camera. So we had to come up with something to have a correct distance from the camera for the actors. So for that, we are using match moved camera, deep compositing. Also, we are using an image plane gizmo that you can find from Nukepedia. There are actually two gizmos. One is from Frank Reuter and the other one is from Riley Gray. For this case, I'm using image plane. The image plane gizmo is a straightforward concept. Think of it as a simple 3D card that is linked to a camera. And this gizmo comes with some handy controls. We can move our image plane closer or further away from the camera. We can choose the reference frame and we can also make it move with the animated camera. This is our camera. It's moving across the sequence with some animation. And when we connect our 2D element, in this case, it's our roto, and it can be any 2D element. We have roto of actor and of the both elements. We can set the reference frame, and it will stick to that frame, which the camera is. So reference frame is connecting the camera animation on that current frame with the image plane. And when you move the camera, you can see that our image plane has moved and it's cropped because we are viewing it from another frame. But we don't want that. We want roto to be sync with our camera. So for that, we just use the frame expression. In this case, we have our image plane moving together with our camera. And we will also have control over the distance. And later we can add this to deep. So for deep from image, we tell that our image plane is, for example, 30 values away from the camera. This allows us to have more accurate placement of the rotos. And this is how we measure this distance. As we already had the boat geometry for other 3D tasks, we converted into simpler shapes for more efficient work within Nuke. And again, as we don't have any camera metadata, this allows us to control image plane distance from the camera, which we are comparing with the real plate. The same technique is being used for rain particles. This way we were able to have all our actors and boat elements inside the rain and also keep background elements behind and foreground rain particles in front of our actors. For this particular shot, we are combining Houdini and Nuke particles. Let me show examples of how we used Nuke particles. We begin with adding a cards. These cards are used as emitters for our rain particles. I added two types of rain, one for small particles and one for big. This is our match moved camera. Later we add a turbulence or any other particle effect that you want. And there is a trick for directional blur that I've learned and would like to share with you. Is besides applying forces like wind or directional speed to particles, you can also move the entire scene in the same direction as our actual plate is moving. This adds an extra touch of lifelike motion blur to rain particles. Later we have all the usual stuff, the grading, adding additional motion blur. And I would like to also highlight this part where we are adding plate colors back on top of the rain particles. For that, we are using combination of multiply and plus. So we take our plate, blur it, and depending from what effect we want to achieve, we increase the multiply by a value of 50 or whatever works better for your shot. And we multiply it with rain particles, added with plus operation. And these grades are helping us to tweak the before merge and after merge values. And this technique helps us to keep all the highlights and colors from the plate. And we are able to tweak it based on the plate. Let me turn this off and on to show you the difference. And also, as an extra detail, we use our particles to distort the light a bit, which is using rain particles to add small amount of distortion. For the last part, we are using dusk rain for regraining. We also have camera shake from Ben McQueven. For the main comp input, we are using camera shake with motion blur. And for the other inputs, we are using the same camera shake to keep same grain, but without the motion blur. Let me show you one trick regarding the degraining that helped us to remove a lot of small details from rain, and which allowed us to preserve those details and apply after regraining. We are using Neat Video's plugin to reduce noise, and I've seen a lot of artists use default auto setting to reduce grain. But if you don't want to read the documentation, one thing that really helps is to go over to Spatial tab and crank up the luminance value. Of course, it would be great if you have an understanding of all of the knobs and values and you can change it depending from your shot. But in this case, cranking up the luminance helped us, and let me show you what I mean. So this is the default, and this is with luminance cranked up. As you can see, the tweaking the luminance allowed us to remove much more noise, which later helped us to bring it all back. And now let's transition to our next project, Boat Story. Here we were able to apply all the knowledge we gained from No Escape, which featured stormy ocean scenes. Our task involved enhancing shots by adding ocean and FX like on previous project. And additionally, there were a few unique tasks which we had to add a CG boat and replace everything else with 2D elements. Our plan was to finish everything faster with pre-recorded plates of Stormy Ocean. While the idea was intriguing from a compositing standpoint, but it gradually became evident that we had limited control over the ocean's appearance because finding suitable 2D element proved challenging. We needed elements that aligned with our requirements, matched the angle, lighting, and storminess. However, after thorough research and effort, we successfully merged all the elements to achieve the desired result. This became this. Everything in here is 2D element except from the CG boat. And for this shot, we replaced everything with 2D elements and it became this one. So the ocean, the small rib, the water interactions, everything is 2D element, except from the CG boat, which is just a test. At the end, everything was replaced with 3D elements. So it became this one, except from the rib. We kept it because there was no point of changing it. It was already looking good, and we were able to transfer it to fully CG ocean. And the other shot, this one, became fully CG again. Now I will try to quickly show our two approaches, one for 3D and one for 2D. So let's start with the 2D. Let's proceed from top to bottom. Our DMP artist created the DMP for the sky, which we are match moving it back on the plate. After extensive review and few tests with ocean elements, we settled on the current version. Let me show you the source. After stabilizing ocean element, we fine-tuned it by applying various transform operations, including scaling and squishing. And eventually we achieved the result that closely aligned with our desired outcome. Similar to a previous task, we have broken down the shot to understand the elements that contribute to its realism. Notably, we focused on aspects like haze and fog. This is one of our draft renders for CGE boat. We were using this to test how it will look on the ocean. And for that task, we decided to apply only rotation on the boat because it was difficult to align CGE boat inside to the ocean. So for that, we take our CGE boat and apply 2D transforms at match moves and do the match moving by hand. We ultimately decided not to use this version, but the process of working on it significantly enhanced our understanding of the technical and visual aspects related to upcoming CGE ocean work. But despite that, I will show a few tricks that helped us to extract foam and splash from our source plate. We are using rotos and keyers, but specifically for water interaction and splashes, except from default keyer, I used TX Hue Keyer. It's created by Thomas Lefebvre. It allows you to select a color and use it as a guide to identify all other pixels with similar luminance and saturation values. Additionally, there are convenient controls to extend or reduce any value. At the end, before applying match move, we have a bit of 2D animation, but as easy as it sounds, it was quite tricky to keep the rib floating on the replaced ocean surface and rook look realistic. For that, we separated water interaction and rib animation. That way, we would have control over splashes and water trail separate from the rib. Similar to previous 2D approach, we're starting with the DMP, then add the ocean, fog, and the rest of the complementary layers. As we don't have time to go over all elements, I'll try to show most useful ones. And here is the example of the rib that we separated and splashes and water interaction, which is allowing us to have better control. Another thing that you can find in Nukepedia is spot flare from Mats Hagbart. It has all the controls that you want for a flare and it's really fun to use. Later we are adding all the complementary layers. There is also one trick that I'm using extensively for rain particles is a method that I learned from online community is to multiply our plate and rain particles together. But the thing that I'm adding is I divide it into three main branches. One is the overall big blur, and then I have two smaller blurs, which allows me to fake how highlights are affecting rain particles. Let me exaggerate this a bit. So we have rain particles, which then get multiplied with three types of blurred highlights from the source, and it doesn't matter if this is CG or real plate. After multiplying it, we are getting these nice highlights, which we can also have control over. So if you want to increase the smaller highlights, you can do that, or you can even decrease the blur value, so it will have less radius. And when applied on our plate, this gives you a realistic effect of the rain. Let me show you, if I'm not doing that, what we have. So we have just uniformly added rain element, which is not looking good. And this allows us to decrease luminance values on the parts that we don't and can't see any rain because there is no light source in here. And whenever we have light source, you can adjust these values to better match with your plate. Later, we are adding additional grade, few lens effects, lens dirt, which is very subtle, and the rest is just adding additional complementary layers using more creative approach, vignette, chromatic aberration. And that's all. If you're watching this back, please do contact us with any questions. Otherwise, we'll be happy to answer them during the live Q&A.
All right. And we're back for the live Q&A. And as we've been saying, please do add any questions you've got in the chat and we can aim to answer those live for you. I think I'll start off here. And I noticed that you were using a lot of gizmos in your scripts. And I wondered if those are standard for the studio or if they're more specific to the show.
Yeah, they are mostly standard, but we do explore. We do our explorations, and if something is useful, we try to test it and use it in the show.
Cool. I'm going to do the classic. You're muted, Max.
Classic mistake. I was going to say that we try not to have too much of a strict pipeline in the sense that we can use quite a lot of gizmos, but obviously we tend to test them and make sure they're not breaking our render farm or anything. But I think we try and be a bit more liberal with our with the amount of gizmos we can use, because there's many out there that are very good and have served us really well. So yeah.
Yeah, why not use a shortcut if you can? It's good. And then I noticed the image plane gizmo, and I wondered about the advantages of using that over DIYing one just in Nuke with a projection.
Actually, it was already there. I mean, why create a new one if the existing one is all thinking doing the work great? So yeah, we went with that road.
Oh, thank you. All right, we do have a few good questions coming through in the chat. So we have quite a broad one about Roto. Keysign Phenomenon says, how do we Roto motion and lens blur in a live action shot? I've got a couple of ideas, but I think I'm going to hand over to you two and if you've got any Roto tips.
Yikes, Roto tips. I'm not sure what they mean by rotoing and lens blur. Don't quite understand that part of it, but
yeah, I wonder if lens distortion.
Angle. Well, it's been a little while since I've been doing hardcore rotoing, but I'd probably say that normally if you've got sort of heavy motion blur, try and find the hardest edge and then use tricks afterwards. I mean, you could probably try doing the edge blur node afterwards. I found that's helped quite often. Obviously you have to turn on your motion blur and your roto node. You can always try adding some other type of motion blur on top. It's kind of dependent on the plate as always, but yeah, I don't know. I don't know if Vahik's had any other experience with this, but.
Well, I can add that there is a pixel fudger tool that really helps. He has a lot of great tutorials which do cover the edge works. I mean, edge extensions, edge blurring with vector motion vectors and stuff like that. So you can all check his great stuff. So hopefully it will cover that question.
And the classic kind of fudge it until it looks good.
Well, yeah. Sometimes there is a bit of that, but those tools are very good, actually, that Vahik mentioned as well. Yeah, I would second that.
All right. So let's bring it back to the comps that we just saw and the breakdowns of the projects. VFX Central asks, how do you extract the splashes from the footage? Luma key? I think we covered a little bit of that. But
yeah, mostly the gears. Yeah, the TXU gear really helped. I mean, I combined a lot of gears and also pre-comped a lot of things. So, and actually, I guess it also depends from the plate. If it was a white plate with white splashes, it was would be impossible to extract.
Yeah, did you end up having to rotate some of that as well?
So yeah, yeah, I also used rotos and maybe small parts of paint.
Nice.
So anything that helps to for a task is accessible.
All right. And somebody says, what techniques did you use to get a good match move for that first shot?
For the 3D one or 2D boat?
I think for the first 3D shot, because I think I recall you saying that you didn't have any camera metadata, and so you had to get a good match move on that.
Yeah, we actually used a 3D match move for that. Yeah, and extracted all the everything that we could from 3D geometry and camera.
Cool. All right. Oh, we're getting loads of questions in here, which is really great to see. I'm trying to see if I can group these into categories. I don't think so. Let's go for the next one, which is around ocean elements. And did you shoot those ocean elements or grab anything from libraries?
If we're talking about the second boat story shot, I think there was it ended up being full CG because there was a couple of attempts to kind of shoot the correct thing actually out at sea, but it never really was stormy enough. And I think that was what the directors were going for. They wanted a really stormy scene. And I don't think there ended up being a way that we could make it work without going the 3D route. So we kind of lent heavily on the 3D team eventually to kind of help us out with a nice stormy ocean. So yeah. there were 2D elements shot, but I guess it was one of those cases where it started in 2D, we thought it was going to be 2D, but no, it went full 3D route and then passed to comp.
Yeah, I was interested to know whether the decision to make the ocean fully CG, did that come from the director or did that come from you guys saying, actually, we're not going to make this stormy without actually just replacing this whole thing for you, and here's a new budget?
I think it was a bit of both, wouldn't you say, Vahik? I think we were attempting to do what we could 2D wise to make it stormy and give it that dramatic look that they wanted. But yeah, I think it was a collaborative process and we had to kind of pass it back to them. And I think they were keen to make it more dramatic, as I say. I think that's how it came across to me.
Yeah. So had you been through a few 2D iterations of the non-3D route and then you switched to the 3D route, and then was there this kind of click, like, yes, that's what I'm looking for?
Yeah, there was a click and a worry because we spent so much time. But yeah, I think, yeah.
All right, and around the 2D, 3D, actually, there is another question in the chat about matching the depth of field with the 2D and 3D elements. I think we covered a little bit of that in the first shot with the like the proxy geo that you laid out there, Vahik, so you had it on cards so you could kind of see the depth. But are there any other tricks that you used that might be useful to know.
Well, we mainly used Zdept for that. We tried to use also Deep, as I showed. But yeah, mainly the classic stuff.
Cool. We have, yes. This person asks an interesting question around optimizations. And actually, when we were watching this through just then in just when we were watching it, I was messaging the guys privately and said, there's a lot of particles in here, you know, did you have to do a bunch of pre-comps and how heavy was that? And this person's asking, how do you optimize the script while working to fit all the 3D effects and simulations? Any script optimization tips that you used for this?
You have to keep all the bounding boxes inside your working area.
Classic.
Especially you have to keep attention on the bounding boxes before motion blurring or defocusing anything. Yeah, and also pre-comping as many passes as you can. Yeah,
and things like removing channels when you can, as early as you can, always helps. And don't make the mistake I once made with a bounding box when it was, I thought I couldn't figure out why I had render problems and why it was so large and all the rest of it. And it turned out my bounding box was so big that I had to zoom out to a tiny level to see a massive bounding box. So always check your bounding boxes, yeah.
I think that's great advice. And also I think we've all been there. We've all been to the stage where we're like, why is it slow? And then you're like, hold on, zoom out forever. And there is a massive bounding box.
Yeah, but pre-comping is definitely the one as well.
Yes. After, is it for pre-comping, kind of intelligently pre-comping at specific points where, okay, I'm done fiddling around with these particles. I can pre-comp that now because I know that I'm not going to need to tweak it too much more. And then if I need to, then I can re-render whatever. Any other tips around that?
Yeah, there is also one trick that I use really, really extensively. It is the one that Nuke allows you to cache your plates on demand, that copies everything on your local drive. So that really also speeding up the work process.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, I think there's an auto crop tool as well, is there not? It might be a Python thing, I can't remember, but I seem to remember I have one in my Nuke script that will run its own auto crop and crop things down to a much more manageable level. That's always a good one to add in.
That is a good tip. Thank you. All right, let's find another question. Did you explore smart vectors for match moving stuff? Presumably not, if you had the camera from the nice 3D department that gave it nicely for you.
Yeah, well, we do use it on some projects, but yeah, in these two shots, we were using match moved camera.
Yeah, I don't think there was anything specific that would have worked with smart vectors on these particular shots. We definitely used it in the show, though, because I think we had a lot of other shots that were sort of blood and wounds and things. So, yeah, it's a great series. I'd recommend people watch it as well. Boat story, yeah. Talking about.
Cool. Yeah, I'm going to have to watch that properly after this. I'm trying to find specific ones for this. I think we've gone through the specific ones from the two projects, but we still have some cool questions in here. And if you're not able to answer this one because it's on about The Witcher, then that's fine. But we have a question here. what were some notable challenges and solutions working on The Witcher Season 3? So I'm putting that out there. You don't have to answer it. But there is a question.
I'd have to pass that to Vahik because I was before my time. So I'd have to pass that to Vahik.
Can you repeat that, please? I missed that.
Yeah, it was around any specific challenges when you're working on The Witcher Season 3.
Oh, yeah, the quality that has to be ever in high demand. All the edges and every small pixel has to match the quality. So what else? All the small details have to match exactly with the time that we should show. I mean, the timeline of the show. We have to be very precise because some of the actors might have clothes from our age. So you have to replace and clean up that.
It's funny you mentioned about how much of a stickler they were for the edges on Witcher, because I worked on the first Witcher and I remember just the edges were just killing me. it was a lot. So it's interesting that you had the exact same, like that's the first thing you said, like, oh, like, yeah, everything had to be quite precise on that.
Edges.
And we also had a different team of compositors working on that project. You can check our and some of the articles we've got.
Cool, thank you, Vahik. All right, I'm wondering whether to open the AI Pandora's box. Yeah, we have a question, the classic question, can AI replace 3D artists? But I think we can also just say, can AI replace artists full stop?
Well,
what do you reckon? This is a hot topic at the moment, isn't it?
Could we reverse the question and say, do you want it to replace artists?
Does that mean we all just go home and have a holiday and that's it?
Exactly. I suppose everyone's talking about this, aren't they? We talk about it at work, but we should probably make an effort to make sure it doesn't replace artists, but and we chatted before the saying we hope that it's more of there's going to be so many AI tools which are no doubt going to be incredibly helpful, but we should be careful to not let it replace artists, and I think we can probably reach that. There's also a lot of it's unpredictable, so it's hard to say. But we have to move with the time. So I'm sure every company is going to start adopting more AI tools and approaches. So cautiously, but yeah, I think we should adopt it somehow, but in a sensible way. I don't know if maybe that all sounds too vague.
No, I think that makes sense. And using it as a tool to accelerate artists, not replace them.
Yeah, I think so. It probably will. Maybe it will reduce the need for the sort of things like roto and match move. You could see that potentially being losing its place, maybe. But time will tell. It's moving quickly.
We're at the beginning of the journey, so it's just starting, isn't it? And it's really interesting.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. I mean, if looking in perspective of a broader timeline, imagine that we wouldn't exist, like 30 years ago. So imagine what will happen from now on, from 5 years ago, later.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting point, because these jobs that we all have didn't exist. And so presumably there's more jobs in the future that will exist that we can't even fathom yet.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, this is really exciting. So eager to see what is going to happen.
All right, let's move on. So we chatted about gizmos a little bit, and we had a question here about your favorite ones or tools that are a must have. What do you reckon?
Well, I can tell for myself. Yeah, those are like everyday tools which are not fully maybe the W hotbox is my favorite one. Yeah.
I knew you were going to say that.
Like the from Wouter Gilsing, where you have like the little floating hotbox thing.
Yeah, I have created all kind of shortcuts and put it inside any imaginable Python scripts that I use daily, and it really helps to speed up the workflow.
Nice. What are your top three shortcuts that you've got mapped to your hotbox?
The one that you allows me to quickly switch operations inside the merge node.
Ah, cool. Yeah.
Also to maybe copy and paste one node to multiple selected nodes. And the one that I really like is that I can, with one click, disable all nodes except from selected one.
Oh, okay. So like exclude this node, but disable all of them apart from this node. Yeah.
Do you need to have any Python knowledge for that, Vahik, to use Hotbox?
Well, it's actually really simple, because you can see how the rest are written, and you can figure out what you want based on the existing one.
Okay. Yeah, I think we'd be remiss to not mention Pixel Fudger tools and the Nuke Survival Toolkit, because we use them a lot. And Adrian Pueyo's gizmos and stuff, because we use them a lot as well. So they're my top three gizmo. They're not gizmo, I suppose, it's a collection of gizmos.
And then Neat Video got a little mention in the video as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also for that W hotbox, I also sometimes ask ChatGPT to write a small script and apply it back inside the Nuke.
See, that's really interesting, because it's an indirect way of using AI to help you comp stuff, right? Have you tried asking it, I don't know, make me your classic shuffle system to separate all passes from a CG element. Have you tried asking it that kind of stuff? And does it give good results?
Well, for now, you have to go simpler. I mean, you have to describe all small details, but I hope in the future it can understand complex tasks.
That would be cool. Somebody, let's look at some more questions then. I see some sympathy for the 50K bounding box in here. That's good to know it's not just us.
Yeah.
And there's quite a broad question here on how to elevate a shot to take it from a kind of amateur to a pro level. Maybe you guys have some ideas on the classic things that perhaps a kind of a junior to mid-level person might not think of that a senior or lead person would do to elevate that shot to the next level? What do you reckon?
Well, I suppose it depends on the type of shot you're talking about, but I suppose if you think about the boat story shot that we did, you know, I'm sure there's much more we could have done to it, but time is always your enemy. But I think you kind of have to start thinking about referencing real life, I think, is the main thing, and how a camera and a lens sees the world. And we tried to do that on the boat story shot with sort of, you know, doing tricks to soften the CG and adding lens effects and, you know, water droplets on the lens, which wasn't an element. We kind of, we took a rain element and defocused it heavily and multiplied it with the plate. And
yeah, I like that bit. That was really nice.
Yeah, so there's, I suppose that's, it's not nothing specific. It's just, I think you have to have, always sharpening your artistic eye is the next thing, I guess, from, because I guess when you're junior, you're trying to learn more how to use Nuke and how to do very specific things, and you worry a lot about how a node works, but then you start to need to know workflows, and you need to start thinking about how you can really sell a shot and how it can, and how you can be efficient with your work. So I think it's efficiency and artistic eye, which takes time, and I'm still learning that. So it's, yeah, I think that would be what I would say.
Cool. Anything to add, Vahik?
Yeah, well, I fully agree with Max. Try to go out and use real cameras to shoot something and understand how it works, and educate yourself in artistic way and technical way, because the thing that I like in Nuke and overall in compositing is that you combine your artistic skills and technical skills together. And that's what drove me inside the compositing.
And then, go ahead.
Sorry, I was going to say, and references is another thing. Always look at references. It's another thing I try and kick myself to remember to do.
Yeah, totally. I had to do a small map painting one time of a street in London, and I was trying to just paint it, you know, from my head and then from a couple of reference images on, you know, online. And then I was just like, hold on, I'm in Soho. So I just walked over to the street, took a couple of photos, and it really helped. Yeah. Just that immediate reference, I could angle just on my phone, just angle where I wanted it. So I think the reference one is a really good shout.
Yeah, and even using something that Michael, the supervisor at owner and supervisor at Vine, I remember him telling me once that, you know, get into Google Street View and you can pan the camera up and down and you can get in your head how perspective lines work. And I thought that was a really good idea because it kind of reminded me, you know, how things stretch out when you look up. So yeah, you could just use different tools for different creative things.
Yes, I've definitely used the Google Street View one as well. That's yeah.
Yeah.
All right, let's move on. I think we've got time for maybe one more question. And there was quite an interesting one here on around the transition from the 2D decision on the ocean to a 3D solution. And obviously it's a lot more costly. And how did you sell that to the client to get them to agree with you that this is the way that we need to go? I know that we've talked about kind of a couple of iterations there, but was there anything specific that you had to do to kind of sell that to them, to get them to potentially spend more money on a more expensive solution?
Well, I guess they saw our previous work, which convinced them to go with the 3D solution.
Yeah, and I think we also had to be iterative with it. So we were providing looks at the 2D approach, and just with communication, we're like, well, there's not a way we can get this looking as stormy as the story requires. So I think it was a back and forth, and then it ended up just expanding into more of a monster shot than originally planned. But I think that's the only way it had to go. And hopefully that served us well anyway, because we built a more exciting and involved shot to sort of put on a showreel and all the rest of it. So it was communication and back and forth that took it there.
Oh, thank you. And I think we ought to wrap up there, unless you guys have any final things that you want to tell everybody in here today about the two awesome projects that we've seen.
Watch the series.
Well, I would like to thank, yeah. And also thank you to the community. Also, it's because everyone, if they're sharing something, definitely gets to the point or some in some show. So the knowledge is shared, which is great.
Sure. And we should probably also credit our great 3D team, who did a good job on our on the boat and everything. So we can't take all the credit for that.
Well, it looks really cool, and
definitely.
Yeah, sorry, Vahik. I think there was a delay and didn't mean to interrupt.
No, it's okay.
The classic Zoom/video chat, slightly awkward delay, not on purpose. All right, thank you both so much. They're really cool to see, and great to have a chat about comp and AI and gizmos and tools and learn some cool stuff. So thank you. All right, so just to let everybody know in here, this time next week, we have our research team in, and they are gonna be telling us all about copycat, and you can get all your copycat questions answered. Foundry's research team has recently published a copycat masterclass, and you can check it out just before the live, and we will post the link in the chat. Well, there we go. Nicole is on it today. She posted in the chat for us. Thank you. All right. Thank you so much again, everybody, for joining. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel if you want to see some more of this. And have a great rest of your day. And thank you, Vahik. And thank you, Max.
Thanks for having us.
See you.